Good afternoon. As always, I would like to welcome you to the lecture series, the United States and World Affairs, the Cold War and Beyond. I'm Klaus Laris, and I'm the Richard M. Krasno Distinguished Professor in History and International Affairs here at the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill. And I'm happy to report it is once again very sunny in Chapel Hill. I would like to thank Richard Krasno and the generous sponsors behind the Krasno Distinguished Professorship for making possible this lecture series on the United States in the world. I would also like to thank the Department of History and our Center for European Studies for their support for this lecture series. We have also received great support from PWAT, the Peace, War and Defense curriculum here, and also generous help from the College of Arts and Social Sciences, the UNC Arts and Humanities Center, UNC Global, and from TIS, the Triangle Institute for Security Studies. In a little while, the lecture today will be available on our YouTube channel. All our previous talks and also the talks in our Ambassadors Forum are available on this YouTube channel. The address is youtube.com/KrasnoUNC. That is one word, and Krasno with a K. And as you know by now, our YouTube channel makes very exciting viewing, so I would like to encourage you once again to view it as often as possible, meaning daily. It is a great pleasure to welcome Professor Thomas Schwartz today. Professor Schwartz is a professor of history and political science at Vanderbilt University in Nashville, Tennessee. Tom Schwartz is among America's leading diplomatic historians. Much of Tom's scholarship has focused on Germany, on American foreign relations, and not surprisingly, to some extent, also on German-American relations. Tom is a prolific scholar and writer, and his first book, America's Germany, John McCloy and the Federal Republic of Germany, was received with much praise and acclaim. It received both the Stuart Barnett Book Prize and the Harry S. Truman Book Prize. The volume was published by Harvard University Press in 1991, and a German version was published the year later. It examines America's dual containment policy toward both West Germany and the Soviet Union during the early Cold War years. Tom is also the author of Lyndon Johnson and Europe in the Shadow of Vietnam, Harvard University Press, 2003. Which was the first series book which looked at the repercussions of the Vietnam War on the European allies and how Europe reacted to that. Together with Matthias Schulz, Tom Schwartz also edited the very useful book, The Strained Alliance, US-European Relations from Nixon to Carter, and that came out with Cambridge University Press in 2009. Professor Schwartz has held plenty of fellowships from the Social Science Research Council, the German Historical Society, the Norwegian Nobel Institute, the Woodrow Wilson Center, and many others. And he also is a past president of the Society of Historians of American Foreign Relations, SHAFER. In addition, he has also somehow found the time to publish plenty of articles and essays in scholarly journals and books. At present, Tom Schwartz divides his time between the writing of two additional books, not just one, two. He is working on a concise history of the Cold War, and he is writing on a book soon to be finished entitled Henry Kissinger and the Dilemmas of American Foreign Policy, of American Power, actually. The later gentleman, Henry the K, features prominently in Tom's talk today. Tom Schwartz will talk about rock star diplomacy, Henry Kissinger, the media, and the politics of American diplomacy. There will be time for questions afterwards. Ladies and gentlemen, it is a great pleasure and honor to welcome Professor Thomas Schwartz today.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I want to thank Professor Laris for inviting me here. Some of you, I'm sure, know Professor Laris has set up one of the foremost speaking series for the study of the history of American foreign relations. And I hope the YouTube channel gets plenty of hits. I really do. I'm very honored to be invited here. I'm also honored because I feel very much a Tar Heel. My daughter Helene graduated this past May. My daughter Evie is a sophomore and is here today. And my youngest daughter is applying now. And if there's anyone here from admissions, please. I have some loyalties to Vanderbilt. They do pay my bills after all. But I find myself now cheering for all Carolina sports teams. And I've come to despise Duke. That wasn't very hard to do, though. I do feel very connected here. Sam Wells, who's one of my mentors over the years, was a professor here. Bill Luchtenberg, who was here last year, taught me at Columbia. Peter Koklanis is an old friend. And I see some friends here as well, which is very, very nice. It's a great department. The challenge I've got today is I've been working on this project way longer than I should have, and I'm told Klaus that I would try to talk in 35 minutes. I'm terrible about length, and so I may find myself having to rush through some things. I really want to provide a lot of time for questions. The problem I have is I want to also expose or use some sources that I think are important. The two of them that I want to use, I want to highlight here, one is the Nixon tapes. To people of my generation, that's a familiar concept. To younger people, it's less. But Richard Nixon, from February of 1971 through July of 1973, recorded his conversations, telephone conversations, Oval Office conversations, secretly. Only he and Robert Haldeman and a couple of other people knew about the recording devices. So they are, it is like having a fly on the wall. This is 3,700 hours, though, of these conversations that exist. I'm going to play short segments that I've used that I think highlight some points. They're a difficult source. It still amazes me Nixon did it, because if you record all this stuff, how do you ever listen to it all at some point? And actually, he was going to use it for his memoirs or whatever, but it's almost amazing. Of course, the recording also was what caused him to have to resign. If he had not recorded the conversations that showed his involvement in Watergate, he would have been able to tough it out and prevented his resignation. Those of you recalling the Bill Clinton situation, if Bill Clinton had recording devices, I think he would have had to resign out of embarrassment. So, I mean, that's the type of thing that can happen. But we've not had anyone recording their conversations in the White House since. Though as historians, we would have loved to have had that available. The second source I want to use or show you is one very particular to Vanderbilt University, and that's the television archive at Vanderbilt University. Since August 5th of 1968, Vanderbilt University has been recording the evening news of all the networks. So they have the evening news from that period. It is a difficult archive to use because its expenses have been such that Vanderbilt has restricted its access in some way. So you have to be at the university to use it. You can use it at the library. It is digitalized now, but it is still difficult to use, and so it has not gotten into the literature and perhaps the way it should. I'm using it today, I hope, to show you a little bit of my argument about the media and the importance. But it does tend to make it hard for me to time my talks because I show clips and materials and I have to make sure the DVD is moving, working, and everything. So forgive me if some of that comes up. Okay. That's the wrong thing. Ah, sorry. Okay. Henry Kissinger doesn't look much like a rock star, I'd imagine, if you look at that. Why I use the title rock star, though, has something to do with how he came to be a celebrity in American life during the period of time in which he was National Security Advisor and Secretary of State. My argument, and I'll present the argument out because I'm not sure I'll get to all facets of it or be able to do everything want, but let me outline it. Kissinger developed and cultivated an image as a nonpartisan figure. I was watching the archive, and when he arrived at the Republican convention in August 1972, Henry Kissinger told the TV correspondent there, Dan Rather, the Nixon administration was making a very serious effort to negotiate an end to the Vietnam War, and that peace is too important to be engaged in partisan politics. And he then added to Rather that the president never talks to me about domestic politics. Throughout his career as both National Security Advisor and Secretary of State, Kissinger consciously cultivated the image of the foreign policy expert above the fray of American partisan politics, seeking only to promote the national interest of the United States. Most historical treatments of Henry Kissinger, in particular, center on his intellectual contributions to American foreign policy, in particular his advocacy of a policy of realism, sometimes Realpolitik, the German word for it, for the United States. Analysts draw attention to Kissinger's strong belief in the importance of maintaining stability and equilibrium within the international system, his rejection of concerns about issues such as human rights and the domestic practices of allies or rivals. Well, all of those things are significant and important. And I don't mean, in some sense, by my presentation today, to denigrate those foci on various aspects of Kissinger. But I'm going to take a different approach to him, highlighting his approach to the domestic politics of foreign policy. Contrary to the image he cultivated, Kissinger came to have a keen sense of the importance of domestic politics and sought to use that to further Richard Nixon's overriding goal of being reelected in November of 1972. The foreign policy trifecta, as Kissinger called it, of 1972, the trip to China, the SALT nuclear weapons agreement with the Soviet Union, and the Paris peace agreement with North Vietnam, were all centered toward this goal of a Nixon electoral victory. Far from being dismissive of electoral politics, Kissinger fully recognized and understood the importance of using foreign policy triumphs, regardless of their actual substance, as a means of gaining domestic support. In reality, Kissinger came to understand and appreciate this foreign policy role and his role as a point man in it. All of this enhanced Nixon's image, appealed to conservative Democrats and independents, and broadened the Republican Party's base, leading to the 72 landslide. In truth, the competition for power at home was also connected to the struggles abroad. Kissinger, at the same time as this, I think was a very important element, Kissinger also furthered his own personal ambitions, demonstrating an extraordinary skill in the manipulation, understanding, and exploitation of the American communications media, both television network news and the printed press. Kissinger befriended, nourished, embraced journalists, reporters, and media executives with extraordinary energy, both in leaking stories and being willing to spend hours explaining his policies and hearing their objections. Journalists reciprocated, treating him far more favorably than other administration figures, especially Nixon, whose own attitude toward the media was one of general contempt and loathing, and would be quite adversarial during his presidency, particularly the role of Spiro Agnew's vice president. Kissinger also recognized that within the relatively colorless Nixon administration, his image as a playboy or swinger increased the media attention devoted to him. Ultimately, his relationship with the media would protect him during the Watergate investigations and allow him to become, for a time in 1973 and 1974, he was effectively president of the United States for foreign affairs. Now, I have used the term rock star. There's all sorts of definitions of rock star. I actually went to the Urban Dictionary. There was one that came up besides the fact that the swinger aspect was part of it, but that he was someone who didn't follow the rules. They make their own. They go out of their way to be extraordinary and different from everyone else. And Kissinger, in many ways, sought that role. His was a great story. It's the type of story I was going to show. I'll quickly show you what happens sometimes when you go to YouTube videos. This one is very strange, but this is Kissinger when he was being appointed National Security Advisor. For whatever reason, the volume is not working on this one. I used it before. I'm not going to show you the whole thing. The reason I actually have it in there was because at the end of it, Kissinger said, when he was appointed Secretary of State, that only in America could a man of my origins come to this position. And in that sense, Kissinger recognized and was aware of what an extraordinary story he was. And so was the media, I think, in that sense. And I think in a way, and I know this may sound a bit outlandish to some of you, there's something of a comparison, I feel, in the way President Obama's story came to grip the media with the way Henry Kissinger's in the early 70s. He was a refugee. He was from Nazi Germany, born in Furth, Germany during the Weimar Republic. He was an Orthodox, very Orthodox Jewish upbringing. He had an intense love of soccer. That was his, that's one of the things that he had during his years, youth, and he talks about it a lot. He was 10 years old in 1933 when the Nazis came to power. The Nazi experience basically destroyed his father. His father was a teacher, lost his job, lost his sense of self, slipped into what could only be called a type of depression. It was the mother who really brought them out of Germany and convinced the family that they had to go first to England, then to the United States. They came in the United States shortly before Kristallnacht in August of 1938. As immigrants and refugees, they settled in Washington Heights in New York, an area that had gotten a fair number of German Jewish emigres, so much so that it was rather nastily described as the Fourth Reich to some people in New York City. This is a picture. This is Henry Kissinger and his brother Walter, who were, I've heard the expression, Irish twins, which they were born within 12 months of each other, very close together in Germany at the time. Many of you know the story that Walter Kissinger speaks German without, speaks English without any accent, because, as he says, he's the Kissinger who can listen, as compared to his brother. Kissinger may have had a very conventional existence had it not been for the great experience of the greatest generation, namely the Army. He's drafted in 1943. Before that time, he really, his aspirations, he was going to be an accountant. He's drafted in 1943. He's selected. The Army gave tests to incoming recruits. He scores very highly on these tests. He's pulled out of the ordinary training. In fact, if you could go back 70 years ago, he was wandering this campus as a member of the Army Special Training Program for a while. He was here in Chapel Hill in late 1943. He was then, the program was canceled because they needed men for D-Day, and so Kissinger ended up landing with other soldiers after D-Day, shortly after D-Day. He met this man next to him, Fritz Kramer, who became his first major mentor in his life. Kramer was a German emigre as well, who saw in Kissinger tremendous talent and set him up with a position with the commanders in the intelligence, counterintelligence corps. Kissinger ends up serving in the occupation of Germany as a commander of the town of Bensheim. At 23 years old, I think of this in the psychological terms of it, here he is, he's back in the country that had expelled him, that killed 13 of his relatives in the Holocaust. Here he is now in command of a small city south of Frankfurt, Bensheim, at the age of 23. In a rather, what I think is very mature and does speak to him in some ways, he used the term Mr. Henry. He didn't want to use his last name because he felt that Germans would immediately think that it was Jews coming for revenge if they knew the name Kissinger, and he called himself Mr. Henry. And he was in command of Bensheim for almost a year, in which he was in charge of catching Gestapos, rooting out other Nazis in the area, helping to get the place back in functioning order. Stayed for another year teaching, actually, at this time. But the central point was that his whole perspective on his life changed. He talked to Kramer about what he should do with his life. Kramer said, you need to go to a university. And Kissinger said, the City College of New York. He said, no, 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 gentlemen, don't go there. You go to Harvard. And Kissinger comes back and on the GI Bill goes to Harvard. He goes to Harvard in 1947. He has a year's credit. He graduates in 3 years. He writes a 388-page honors thesis as an undergraduate called The Meaning of History. After his thesis is written, Harvard passes a rule that no thesis should be longer than 100 pages. So it's called the Kissinger Rule. But even that, the meaning of history as a topic, gives you some idea of his ambition. He enters the government department for a PhD. His mentor is William Yandel Elliott, Vanderbilt class of 1917. Elliott was not a great scholar, but he was a great networker, and he was interested in connecting people to the government, and he helps Kissinger's careers in so many ways. They set up an international seminar where they bring in talented students from Europe and then later from Asia, the Middle East, Africa. They bring in talented students, professionals, and others for a semester or for a summer in Cambridge, and where Kissinger gives lectures and talks to them about the United States. It's a type of outreach, but also designed to influence public opinion. And later, when Kissinger becomes Secretary of State, what you find in many of the television broadcasts that I looked at, that people refer to the fact he's meeting with a former student, Giscard d'Estaing, the Premier of France, who had come to his seminar in the summer during this 1950s and 1960s period. It's a remarkable set of networking, but it's partly through Elliott that Kissinger is connected to that. He also sets up a journal that Kissinger sets up called Confluence, which allows Kissinger to ask for articles from leading intellectuals around the world. Kissinger writes a doctoral dissertation and book, A World Restored, that praises the diplomacy of the 19th century Austrian diplomat Clemens von Metternich for his effort to craft stability in the Napoleonic Wars. It is very much an idealized version of Metternich, not a very historical version. There is an apocryphal story that some people told me at Harvard that one of the chairmen of the history department said, oh yeah, that would get a PhD in government, but not in history. But Kissinger's thesis nevertheless gets out there. Elliott connects him with Nelson Rockefeller. Nelson Rockefeller is one of those great might-have-beens of American politics, from the very obviously from great wealth, the Rockefeller fortune. Rockefeller wants to become president of the United States. He needs brains around him. He recruits Kissinger to write his speeches. But Kissinger also heads up his special studies project, which is basically the 1950s equivalent of think tanks, and sets up a project to look at the future of the United States. I actually think there's a good dissertation in writing about how the special studies project actually imagined what America would be like in 10 years and compared to what it was. What's fascinating about the Rockefeller project is it has had no mention of race as a central issue as they saw 10 years future. Fascinating in that sense of how much they missed. Rockefeller nevertheless promotes Kissinger's career, helps Kissinger. Kissinger publishes his a popular book on nuclear weapons and foreign policy, which becomes a bestseller. And this becomes one of his first appearances on television. Let's see if I can get it up here. Oh, come on. There you go.
Time. I know it doesn't sound sensible, and nor does the destructiveness of modern weapons sound very sensible. What is required here is a completely new order of thinking. I hold no particular brief for the specific limitations which I recommended. What I am saying is this. Both sides, if they know one thing, they know that an all-out war will mean the destruction of civilization, of their own as well as of the other. They also know they will therefore have an interest in keeping any war that does break out to the smallest possible proportion. If they're looking for an excuse to expand it, they will expand it. I am assuming they're looking for an excuse to limit it. What we have to do is to bend our ingenuity into finding means to limit any war that might break out, either through accident or through design. Whether these particular limitations are absolutely the right ones, I wouldn't maintain.
I'm going to stop it there. He wrote a book basically arguing on the need to think in terms of the possibility of limited nuclear war. Strategy at that time was based on the idea of massive retaliation, that the United States would undertake a full-scale nuclear attack if there were Soviet aggression. Kissinger says that's increasingly impossible to conceive, that otherwise we'll find the West nibbled away by communist aggression. We have to think in terms of limited war. His book captures the spirit of that time, as in many ways as strange as it is. It captures the spirit of the late 1950s of thinking for some other options than this sort of apocalyptic nuclear belief. The book is a bestseller. Brings Kissinger into the forefront of what are called defense intellectuals of the time and sets him up, in some sense, for the 1960s. But his career does not assume the proportions he does, in part because of his politics. As Nelson Rockefeller was a Republican, when the Kennedy administration comes in and brings people from Harvard, Kissinger only goes part-time. Part of that is also his relationship with the National Security Advisor, McGeorge Bundy, who had been his dean at Harvard. Bundy was not a fan of Kissinger's understood Kissinger could be used for certain things, particularly in as expertise on weapons and on Germany, but did not want to bring him in full time. Kissinger was angry, ended up resigning from the Kennedy administration, but comes back in the Johnson period and actually is extremely active in trying to get secret negotiations with the North Vietnamese during the Johnson years, and plays a particular role in trying to start negotiations to end the Vietnam War, which of course escalated during the Johnson period. Kissinger also kept up ties to both Republicans and Democrats. Kissinger tried to always maintain a certain image of independence, and he worked quietly for Johnson. He also maintained ties to Rockefeller, in a sense trying to walk the middle ground, which still existed in American politics at the time, walk that middle ground between the parties, and was quite successful at it. Nixon wins very narrowly in 1968. I've just put this up just to remind you, it was a fraction, 1% victory in the popular vote, a little bit more in electoral vote, but it's a very narrow win. He gets 43% of the vote because there's a third party candidate, but he's very aware this is not an overwhelming victory for the Republicans. And that's one reason I wanted to put that up there, is because I think it reminds us of how central re-election was to Richard Nixon for the 4 years of his first term. Kissinger decides to appoint Henry Kissinger, stealing one of Rockefeller's top people. Kissinger and Nixon had no relationship before 1968. but Kissinger, Nixon brings him in to his administration. What one has to realize, and let me set the context, is that America in the late 1960s was in a particularly difficult situation. Whatever I think of the polarization of our politics today, I think about past American situations. And in the late 1960s, polarization was acute, but not directly on political parties, but within the society as a whole. You had 500,000 men in Vietnam with no strategy for victory. You had serious racial conflict and violence at home. You had a perceived great overextension of America on foreign policy commitments and defense spending. You had a country turning inward and public support for foreign policy limited. Kissinger is brought in as national security advisor. Nixon makes him one of his first appointments. And I argue that the key in understanding the appointment of Henry Kissinger is understanding how Nixon wanted to both centralize power in the White House, conduct foreign policy with a certain degree of secrecy, cut out the bureaucracy, but also make sure that credit for foreign policy successes would go to the president, not to others within the administration, would go to the president, would be of importance in his political situation, and for, in a sense, for domestic political purposes. First 2 years of the Nixon administration, I argue, were relatively a failure. The quotation, "you can't lose them all," is actually something Henry Kissinger said to a reporter who called him up in late 1970, sort of toward the end of the first 2 years, after they had had a modest diplomatic success in the Middle East. And the reporter said to him, "do you have any comment?" And Kissinger said, "yeah, well, we're going to change the motto of the administration. You can't lose them all." Because of the perception they were succeeding. Nixon had talked in his inaugural about wanting to institute an era of negotiation to replace confrontation, compared himself to Woodrow Wilson as a peacemaker. He wanted to settle the Vietnam War in 6 months. He hoped to get help from the Soviets. None of this worked out. He backed off threats of military escalation, and he started to withdraw troops. But when he sent troops into Cambodia in April of 1970, he initiated a huge domestic protest that led to the shooting of students at Kent State and to a shutdown of universities across the country. It seemed like he was accomplishing nothing. Instead, protests against the war were accelerating. Hanoi rejected his offers, and in that sense, nothing had been accomplished. He's tried to start the process toward China, but the talks broke down, and in fact, the Chinese almost shot down a U.S. aircraft in July 1970. That things were not moving on China, even though China and Russia were fighting with each other. Nixon wanted desperately a summit with the Soviets before the midterm elections. They rejected it. He proclaimed the Nixon Doctrine, a policy of retrenchment and pulling back. But in fact, by 1970, things were not going well. What did go well between 1969 was the development of an image that Henry Kissinger started to craft. He was on the cover of Time within the first month. That's the first featured as a key presidential advisor. Even though the Secretary of State supposedly was the formal advisor, Kissinger was already perceived as having more influence. He also developed this reputation in Washington initially as a swinger, as a bachelor in the colorless administration. Maxine Cheshire, who is the Washington Post society columnist, regularly wrote about Kissinger's comings and goings in Washington. And she also provided one of the most famous stories. Kissinger arrived late at a party at a Washington socialite's house, clutching a manila envelope with White House stamped on it. The party was in honor of the Today Show host Barbara Walters, and it took place shortly before Nixon was to deliver a key Vietnam speech on November 3rd. Kissinger never put the packet down all evening, not to eat or drink or talk, and when someone questioned him about it, he jokingly remarked, "It's my advance copy of Playboy." When Sally Quinn, another Washington Post reporter, remarked, "Oh, so you're a swinger underneath it all," Kissinger answered, "Well, you couldn't call me a swinger because of my job. Why don't you just assume I'm a secret swinger?" Kissinger cultivated this idea that he was an active, he went out with a whole set of actresses, socialites, others in the Washington area. He wrote about Washington society. He said, a person is accepted as soon as he enters the charmed circle of the holders of power. With the rarest exceptions, he is dropped when his position ends. In Washington, the appearance of power is therefore almost as important as the reality of it. The appearance frequently is its essential reality. He cultivated this, encouraged it, even though, as his one of his biographers, Walter Isaacson, writes, the dirty little secret about Kissinger's relationship with women was that there was no dirty little secret. He liked to go out with them, but not home with them. He was the most celibate lecher in Washington, even though he did acquire the nickname after the first 60 Minutes profile of him, a playboy of the Western Wing of the White House. One of my favorite stories, though, is he flirted with this one socialite, Barbara Hauer, who was a Democrat, telling her that he was headed off to a meeting at Midway with Nixon to negotiate withdrawals from Vietnam, but that when he got back, he would like to call her for dinner. She said to him, if you bring about withdrawal from Vietnam, you can call me and do whatever you want with me. And Kissinger said, dinner will be sufficient. Kissinger's image, and I know that this is often seen, I used to show pictures of him in this sort of thing, and it usually startled students of mine that he was something of a sex symbol, but he was actually doing it, was quite conscious and cultivated, and I'll show you a little bit about how that features in the television. Playboy bunnies actually voted him the man they most wanted to date, and they have this picture of him in 1972. But he became this featured figure in all of this. I don't have time for this particular clip. I wanted to—it's a home movie thing, but I'll hold off on that. The midterm elections were a disaster for the Republicans in 1970. The Republicans gained 2 seats in the Senate, lost 9, but the Democratic margin was very high. Nixon thought he'd be a one-term president. He considered an end of the war announcement. He told advisors now that he wanted them to highlight Kissinger because of Kissinger's media favoritism. He thought that would be an important part of what to do. Nixon was frustrated. Kissinger provided him reassurance. Kissinger was also his contact to television and media authorities. I'm going to play a section from a tape. I won't play the whole thing, even though the whole thing is actually really interesting to listen to, but I'll play the beginning of it. You'll see why. But keep in mind, Nixon has just delivered a speech on Vietnam. The Republican Party leaders have been coming to him telling him, you've got to end the war now. You know, it's good. You're dragging our party down. You've got to do this. He is angry with them. And Kissinger is providing him reassurance that what he's doing is right.
Yeah, the president.
Yeah, I agree.
This was the best speech you've delivered since you've been in office. I don't know.
I just know that number 30 is better, but we will never have a moment. We'll never have a moment like that again.
Well, the November 3rd speech was not well delivered, the president, if you remember.
Yeah.
It was a powerful speech.
Yeah.
This one was really movingly delivered. And I don't know whether you saw the commentary.
I didn't look at the commentary. Well, I don't care what the bastards say.
Well, but this is all making sense. Well, no one was fly-specking it. John Chancellor was very favorable. Everyone is saying a strong man sticking to his guns, carrying out his policies, not being driven off. Dan Rather, very positive. Marvin Kauf, very positive.
All the commentators.
The only guy who was fly-specking it a little bit is the Pentagon correspondent, who had been...
How about Howard Smith? What did he do? He would not.
At least I didn't see it.
Yeah. I'll say one thing. This little speech was a work of art. I mean, I know a little something about speech writing, but by the time we got it down in that little conclusion, I think that was done. And it was no act, because no actor could do it. But no actor in Hollywood could have done that well. I thought that was done well, didn't you think?
Well, no actor could have written it. You couldn't have done it unless you had meant it.
Yeah. But did that come across? I mean, it was
the president. I had after all heard it before.
Yeah.
I had a lump in my throat.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's got a lump in mine. That's strange, you know?
I would love to play the whole thing. It actually goes on and reassures him he's doing the right thing, and it's all that. But what's key is I wanted to play the section about the commentary. I don't care what the bastards say. Well, he does care. And Kissinger, of course, is his link to the media and to that. And what you find with Nixon over this time period is that, in effect, this will become the key. Shortly after this speech was given, It was a sort of low point in the Nixon presidency in early 71. Shortly after this speech, they get their first indication that they're going to get some possibilities in foreign policy. And that first one comes when they get a message from the Chinese that the Chinese are interested. This comes in the light of the ping pong diplomacy when the Chinese invite American ping pong team to win. To come to China. This fascinates the American media. There's nonstop coverage. I looked at this in the TV archive, every evening news program. And I wanted to see how did Kissinger and company react to it. Well, here I'll play just the beginning of a tape conversation. Kissinger is at a party. Nixon calls him.
Hello. I was wondering how they, if you checked in to see how they played the Chinese thing today?
Oh, yeah, it was tremendous. It was the lead item on every, I didn't see it myself, I was with Bob Kirvin, but I talked to Haig.
Yeah.
But he says it's been a tremendous thing on television. It's been the lead item on every television thing. And so,
rather than Vietnam for change.
It's gone on and on and on. Yeah, and I found it.
They go on, I mean, but they were aware. They were aware that they had the possibility to, in a way, change the narrative, change the way in which people were seeing it, the war and the rest. I don't have time. I'd love to play this long conversation because they're basically considering who should go to China on the secret mission. Nixon knows Kissinger desperate to go to China. He sort of dangles it out there and then suggests all these other people so that Kissinger has to sort of pull back. Finally, he even suggests Tom Dewey, who had already died, and Kissinger has to say, well, he's dead. But ends up, of course, Kissinger does go to China. And that becomes a phenomenal thing. But what's fascinating about reading, and the opening to China has all sorts of implications in many respects, what's really fascinating to read is how much Nixon invested it with politics. For example, he wanted to keep it completely secret, not just for the Chinese wanted it wide open. They wanted to have it publicized before it was announced. But Kissinger went secretly because Nixon wanted the surprise factor. And he wanted it partly against his political opponents, but he also wanted it partly against to be able to captivate Americans. He wanted the Chinese also not to invite Democrats. One of the things Kissinger, when he went to China, he had to tell them, don't invite lots of opposition party people. This is our thing. Don't make it a political football. I'm not sure how the Chinese took that, but they did. The television coverage, ultimately, would be central to the China trip. There would be a huge American advance team, and the choreography of the coverage of Nixon's trip to China is astounding. They planned every minute, all the events, all the sort of footage, the coverage, the rest. It was, in effect, the Chinese primary for Nixon when it finally came off in February of 1972, Nixon's primary. They took a poll at the time. 98% of the people were aware of Nixon being in China. That was an astoundingly high number. For any event, some Americans are always out to lunch, but almost everyone knew that Nixon had gone to China. The SALT agreement. I'm jumping out of chronological order here, but I want to play a brief moment here. What you're going to hear in this conversation, Nixon has sent Kissinger to talk to a series of reporters about the opening of the SALT talks. The SALT talks were designed to bring down the nuclear weapon race with the Russians. And what I like about this is just how clear Nixon is about, I'm having that same problem, Jace, the Firefox doesn't want to, I'll skip it for now, actually. You've gotten the flavor of the tapes. Let me move on to the summit, of course. You see Nixon, Kissinger, Brezhnev, also designed around the television coverage of it, the agreements that took place. In January of 1972, Nixon decided to announce that he had been sending Henry Kissinger on secret missions to negotiate with the North Vietnamese. I want to show you the way this was covered by the television. illustrate this in the sense that Kissinger's profile had expanded enormously after the trip to China. He was now subject of all sorts of articles. And in January of 1972, this particular story featured.
And David Culhane in New York.
Good evening. Since President Nixon revealed last night his latest eight-point proposal for peace in Indochina, the reaction has been swift, but not altogether heartening. The communists, for instance, dismissed Mr. Nixon's statement as propaganda and said it was perfidious. Further, they chided the president for allegedly breaking a promise to keep the secret talk secret. But the communists stopped short of actually rejecting the proposal. In Washington, presidential advisor Henry Kissinger discussed the plan and his many secret trips to Paris to negotiate with the communists. Dan Rather reports.
The White House East Room was turned into a stage setting for Dr. Kissinger's performance. Besides starring in the Nixon administration as Secretary of State without title, swinging bachelor ladies' man, and the president's secret negotiator, Kissinger is widely acclaimed as a masterful explainer of White House policy. Some call him a briefer, others a propaganda artist. All agree he is skillful. But Kissinger usually does his explaining on a don't quote me, don't use my name basis. Today, as part of a carefully orchestrated White House effort to enlist support for the president's war policy and peace proposals, Kissinger made one of his rare on-the-record appearances. No sound cameras or recording equipment were allowed, but silent filming was, and reporters were free to quote Kissinger directly by name. These were his major points. The White House secretly offered August 1st.
I'll stop it there. Let me see if I get my... Kissinger's role in this, I think, is... Kissinger now becomes a much more central public figure. He is now actively engaged in negotiations on Vietnam, but he's also very aware of what the president's political agenda is. And you get a little bit of that. I'm not sure if this one will come up. Yeah, it's not. Okay. The technical problems are going to defeat me today. But ultimately, Kissinger ends up becoming quite aware of how the president wants to campaign on Vietnam, and particularly to defeat George McGovern in 1972, the Democratic candidate. Kissinger will give a press conference on October 26, 1972, after coming too close to an agreement with the North Vietnamese, in which he makes, for the first time, he's quoted actually directly audio on audio, that peace is at hand in October 26, 1972. If the thing were working, I would play you a conversation where Nixon, Kissinger calls Nixon, and Nixon says to him, Henry, did you see the evening news tonight? All the evening news shows are on about peace is at hand. And Kissinger says, yes, Colson's told me now that he thinks we've wiped McGovern out. It was the understanding of the politics of ending the war in Vietnam. It comes through, along with the diplomatic aspects, comes through strongly toward the end of the Nixon administration. Both men become Time Men of the Year. This irritates Nixon to no end that he has to share this award with Kissinger. But it shows, in a way, how much Kissinger had become a part of the Nixon story and how much Nixon's triumph and then the foreign policy triumphs were also shared and, in part, also seen as the product of Kissinger. I would have shown, it doesn't look like I'm having much luck on the internet, so I'll stop it there. I would have shown Nixon, of course, campaigned as a foreign policy successes, and I think those foreign policy successes were central to his landslide. The colors are a little different than what we use now, but you can see the difference between what Nixon had and then only Massachusetts and the District of Columbia voted for McGovern in 1972, and Nixon won an overwhelming landslide from 43% of the vote to 60% of the vote. Then Watergate. If I had a bit more time, I'd get into some of the connections between Kissinger and Watergate, which are not insubstantial. But Kissinger was able to insulate himself, and partly also. The television archive has a number of editorials of reporters and others saying we have to keep Henry Kissinger away from Watergate, in effect, saying that Kissinger was not involved, and Kissinger should not be tarred with it. But Watergate serves to weaken and undermine Nixon. from about March of 1973 into April of 1973. You could almost see it in this face, not quite, but ultimately by the time Kissinger is appointed Secretary of State in August of 1973, he has become the sort of central figure. I'm going to skip ahead and see if I can play. I'll play one DVD, because this television coverage is particularly interesting. Once Kissinger becomes Secretary of State, he has to deal with international crises. One of the key ones that breaks out is the Yom Kippur War in October of 1973, 40 years ago, the war in the Middle East. Kissinger, of course, engages in a whole set of diplomatic negotiations then. He becomes central to trying to end that war. In the process, he becomes seen by many as having, in effect, almost usurped Nixon's role. Let's see here. We have to go through the copyright laws here. But the clip I'm going to play comes from early 1974, and I think illustrates, in a sense, how much Kissinger has now become seen as the key figure, while Nixon has, in the process of facing Watergate, had to
comment on Russia's Alexander Solzhenitsyn, an international hero. With the energy crisis our major domestic problem, the Arab oil embargo is looming continually larger as the major international problem. At a news conference in San Clemente today, Secretary of State Kissinger discussed a new approach to dealing with the embargo. ABC's Stephen Geer reports.
After several days of discussion with President Nixon here at the San Clemente compound, Secretary of State Kissinger told us the president will make a major effort to solve the international energy crisis. Dr. Kissinger said details of the effort will be revealed in coming weeks, but he indicated that talks between the major consuming nations and the Arab countries will be proposed.
We have understanding for the initial Arab position. Nevertheless, we believe that it becomes increasingly less appropriate for Arab governments to pursue discriminatory measures against the United States. But we hope that there will be progress on the oil embargo issue, together with a general easing of the situation in the Middle East.
Kissinger was cautiously optimistic about the Geneva peace talks. He said he does not believe the Israeli elections will have any effect on the current discussions on troop disengagement. The ultimate effect, he said, must await the makeup of the Israeli cabinet. In response to a question, Kissinger said he has no reason to assume the president will be impeached, and stressing his daily communication with Mr. Nixon, Kissinger denied that because of Watergate, he has assumed control of foreign policy.
The constitutional responsibility for conducting foreign policy resides in the president. The Secretary of State has to be the agent of the president, or he represents nothing. And in this present situation in America, I believe that government has to be regular and it has to be conducted on the basis of existing constitutional practice, and I therefore totally reject the idea that I'm attempting to conduct an independent policy.
A presidential trip to Europe this spring is possible, the secretary said, if progress in European talks continues, and he said the president still plans journeys to Japan and the Soviet Union. We asked about Kissinger's recent flight to California.
Coming out here, you traveled commercially. I just wondered what your reaction was to that flight and the attention you got on it. Did you feel like an average traveler?
Well, they don't have stewardesses on Air Force One.
The Secretary of State manages to retain the famous Kissinger humor, no matter how serious the problems that face him. The most immediate of those problems, his talks tomorrow in Washington with Israeli Defense Minister Moshe Dayan. More on that from ABC's Ted Koppel.
For all the fanfare and publicity that surrounded the opening of peace talks in Geneva last month, Israeli officials here in Washington are suggesting that tomorrow's meeting between Secretary Kissinger and General Dayan will be the one to produce results. Until their own elections 3 days ago, the Israelis were reluctant to even attend the Geneva conference, but did so at American insistence so that the momentum of peace be kept underway. According to Israeli sources, those substantive discussions in Geneva have been deliberately kept to a minimum. Now that the elections are over, the government of Prime Minister Golda Meir has been given at least a grudging mandate to negotiate a disengagement of forces along the Suez Canal. And it's believed that General Dayan is bringing Israel's specific terms for disengagement with him to Washington tomorrow. Although for obvious reasons those terms are not being made public, Israeli officials are privately sounding quite optimistic. And significantly, they have no quarrel with recent reports that a preliminary agreement on the separation of Israeli and Egyptian forces is likely by the end of this month. The hope for peace, though, one Israeli told me today, lies not in Geneva, but wherever Henry Kissinger is. This is Tim Crawford, ABC News at the State Department.
An Israeli newspaper.
I wanted to keep it on for that point. The idea that the hope for peace where Henry Kissinger was, Kissinger presides over a couple of disengagement agreements. Again, the Time magazine, Mideast Miracle. Again, bringing together Sadat and Rabin. Kissinger's own lessons of diplomacy, and I'm gonna close off here because I've gone on too long. Kissinger would, of course, the media taketh, the media taketh, giveth, and the media taketh away. And after Nixon's resignation, there was a renewed focus on Kissinger, and Kissinger came under much more criticism toward the end of his time in office, 1975-76. And I could go on and show some of those reports because there were a whole series. But for a time, he actually served, I think, essentially as President of the United States. His peace settlement in Vietnam collapsed. Saigon was ultimately overrun. Kissinger came out, gave a series of speeches trying to convince the American people that a different approach to foreign policy, one moving beyond American exceptionalism and an understanding of the inherent limits of power and tragedy involved in making choices in foreign policy, was the only way a superpower could behave. In fact, Kissinger made a lot of argument about the limits of power for the United States, not unlike, I would argue, President Obama's arguments and others in the last few years about the fact that the United States has to retrench, pull back. The complication came that Kissinger's own ascendancy, the phenomenal career of an immigrant and Jew to the heights of power, seemed as much a testament to American exceptionalism as a critique of it. And Kissinger's willingness to advise presidents to use American power abundantly, from bombing in Vietnam, mediating in the Middle East, and playing off the Soviet Union and China, hardly seemed to call for its limitation. Professor Kissinger's lectures about foreign policy and limits seemed contradicted by his own career and behavior. And it was not a lecture his students, the American people, and their representatives wanted to hear, except as it developed in moments of national adversity, economic stress, and political crisis. Then it was often forgotten, and the worst elements of these were over. In that sense, Kissinger's career and his role as a diplomat, there was a tension between, in a sense, the way in which he acquired and demonstrated and exercised power, and the type of lessons and approach that he believed the United States should most maintain. In that sense, the rock star diplomat the lessons of the rock star diplomat were not those, were not consistent with the diplomacy and the behavior that he had been in office. I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Thank you very much for an enlightening talk about rock star diplomacy. And of course, we shouldn't forget that Henry Kissinger is still active, even at the age of 90, which he celebrated recently. He's still consulted very widely by...
He appears on the Colbert Report.
Indeed. And any Russian leader who travels to the United States apparently calls on in New York.
The
Chinese one, yes. And apparently he has been to China 40 or 50 times since he resigned had to resign as Secretary of State. So the rock star diplomat is still with us. Let me ask you a couple of questions before we open it up to questions from the audience. You very nicely pointed out that Kissinger was almost no one, really, in international politics, but quickly was elevated to one of a very important person in the Nixon administration on Time magazine cover within a month. But how did he do that? That he, you know, obtained that insight, that he was able to network so quickly? Not, it didn't take him a year, but as you said, 30 days. I mean, he's intelligent, he's bright, anything, but why so quickly? How did that come about?
I think he had observed others in Washington in the Washington game. He knew, though, that Nixon's decision to invest him with as much authority gave him the ability to give journalists what they needed: stories, leaks, information. And he understood their needs, and he was very good at talking to journalists. The reporter on Time who did that profile, actually, about 5 or 6 years ago, I was giving this talk, which shows how long I've been at it. I'm sorry. But the reporter who gave that talk came up to me afterwards. You know, I did that profile. You know, he had gone to Harvard. He saw the Harvard professor was promoted. And they did the sympathetic profile. And I think in that sense, Kissinger understood aspects of the American establishment. He understood aspects of how his position at Harvard, his ability to, in a sense, play on his personality and strength. He's also a brilliant man, and I think journalists were intimidated and awed by him. And he actually had the reputation, which is complicated given some of his reputation today, he had the reputation of never lying, which, of course, is not seen as his role today. But he had the reputation of being honest to journalists, that really they felt that they got the truth from him, and that he understood their needs and gave them the truth about foreign policy and information. So all of that worked fast.
And I guess he understood Richard Nixon and his personality.
I would not go that far. I think it took him a long time to figure out Nixon. He came to understand Nixon. Partly because he also, William Sapphire, who was a speechwriter, said that Kissinger had a tuning fork, and he tuned it to Richard Nixon. And he, in a sense, he sublimated, and he also, you get a little bit of that in that conversation. He was very deferential, in fact, to the point of very obsequious to Richard Nixon on many occasions. And the conversations do not flatter him. And he praised the president constantly, and he reinforced his insecurities, or tried to overcome his insecurities. I don't think he fully understood Nixon. I think he got a sense of what Nixon wanted and did, but there was always a gap between them. They never engaged on any sort of personal level. There was no personal relationship between them. It was a professional one.
But they prayed together at the end, didn't they?
At the end, they prayed together. It's a very famous moment.
That's a personal relationship.
Kissinger, the story that Professor Lawrence is referring to was in a book by Woodward and Bernstein called The Final Days, and it was the day before Nixon resigned in disgrace. He had Kissinger come to the Oval Office, and Kissinger spent a lot of the time telling him, history will treat you better, Mr. President, history will treat you better, and that as they were walking out, Nixon asked him to pray. Woodward and Bernstein said Kissinger got down on his knees, which Kissinger denies in his memoir. It says he doesn't remember in his memoirs. It's very strange. But they did, you're right that they did, but there was always a distance, and Kissinger said some very unflattering things after he left office. They made up a bit, but there was always a distance. Kissinger told Jeremy Suri, one of our friends and colleagues, that he wishes he had gone to baseball games with Nixon and things like that. But he didn't get invited over for dinner the way Secretary of State Rogers, who was a personal friend. There was always a distance.
Thank you. Let me quickly jump to Watergate, which you mentioned and kind of briefly only referred to. I once asked Kissinger myself about Watergate and his involvement, and it wasn't the most popular question you could ask him. So I didn't obviously get a very good answer. What is your answer? What was Kissinger's involvement in Watergate? Was there any?
Well, I'm still sort of sorting through how I want to answer this question, in the sense that it's clear to me that Kissinger understood a lot of the practices of the Nixon administration, the wiretapping. He, in fact, had not advocated it, but given names to J. Edgar Hoover, journalists and others to wiretap to see if they were leaking sensitive information. Some 17 figures early in the administration, some of which is staff, Morton Halper and others. So he knew some of them. He also, after the Pentagon Papers leak, he told Nixon that there had to be something done about this. And he was quite insistent that this was damaging to American diplomacy, even though the Pentagon Papers really did not concern Nixon's administration. But it was a bit like Snowden in more recent times, but Kissinger had a fit. He said, this is intolerable, Mr. President, it has to be done. And part of me thinks he must have had some sense that Nixon then set up the plumbers who ultimately were the key to Watergate was the break-in of Daniel Ellsberg's psychiatrist's office by the plumbers. I don't think Kissinger knew of that, but I think he knew that the administration was aggressively pursuing leaks and that there was some behavior there that he kept away from recognizing. But I do think he underestimated how much his constant talk about national security and secrecy could have influenced the environment in the Nixon administration toward the idea of going after figures like Ellsberg and others. And that ultimately led to the wiretaps and the press.
Okay, thanks very much. Let me open it to the public. Yes, Mike.
And we have our microphone here that we can pass around.
Sure. Talking to that place.
All right, thanks. Recorded for posterity, like Nixon and Kissinger. You've suggested quite convincingly, I think, that Kissinger understood the American media, understood how Washington worked. But I wonder if we have to come to the conclusion that maybe he didn't understand the United States in some profound sense. Kissinger writes somewhere, I think, in A World Restored, that the truest test of a foreign policy is whether it attains domestic legitimacy, achieves domestic legitimacy. And you mentioned towards the end his Heartland speeches, in which he attempts to justify the neglect for human rights and this pragmatic, tragic view of foreign policy, which seems to me to be fundamentally at odds with the exceptionalist American understanding of the United States' place in the world. So in that sense, Kissinger, for all of his brilliance, seems to be cutting completely against the grain of the American tradition of diplomacy and perhaps willfully misunderstanding that tradition and trying to row in the wrong direction, so to speak. Could you comment on that?
Yeah, I think that's a great question, and I think it's a great point, and I'd argue that in a similar way. I guess what I was getting at today, though, is that he understood the needs of the immediate political situation of 1972. And I think what I have observed is that as much as there is a sort of longer term in some of these ideas of American exceptionalism, wanting to stand for human rights, there's also the very practical element of war weariness. We're very familiar with this now because we're seeing it on Iraq and Afghanistan. We're seeing how, you know, the reaction to doing anything about Syria, despite the awful abuses of chemical weapons, was so opposed to the United States, and President Obama's attempt to invoke American exceptionalism went flat, that it's not a permanent thing, that this is reflected, it is affected by public opinion and other areas. And in 1971-72, no one wanted to talk, for example, about human rights in China. What they wanted to talk about was peace, that if the Chinese are talking to us, that means we don't, you know, Vietnam doesn't matter, these things don't matter. If we're balancing them with the Russians, we're in much better straits. So in that sense, I think that, you know, Kissinger understood, and that did favor his approach to foreign policy. And it politically, for a time, it was good. What Kissinger couldn't keep up with was the changing nature of American opinion and underlying things that he did try to fight against in the Heartland speeches, but found in 1975 and 76 that American politics was moving in two different directions. One, a right wing moving toward greater anti-communism and criticism of his detente policy, and on the left, a criticism of his attitudes toward human rights and violations of them and American indifference to it. Agree with you in that sense, but I think what the point I was trying to get across here today was just how he tried to tune to Nixon's political needs in that context, and it did fit with his larger view of foreign policy. He ultimately found out that his larger view of foreign policy had problems when the environment changed.
Thank you. Konrad Jarosz, can you pass it on?
I don't have a question, I just have a mini anecdote for for the background. The aunt of my wife when she was a schoolgirl and Henry was born, the class gave the father a baby outfit for Henry K.
Do you know if they have it?
I don't know what happened to it after.
Yeah, no.
Thank you. Any more questions? Here, please.
I guess Kissinger always impressed me as a master negotiator. In fact, I would say that that was maybe his greatest strength. And I was wondering if you could comment on the shuttle diplomacy that he did compared to what happened during the Carter administration when Sadat and the Israelis came to an agreement.
I think he was a master negotiator. And I didn't get a chance to highlight that. I would have shown you a couple of other clips that just sort of highlight, you know, there's one from after he got the Syrian agreement. Henry Kissinger did it, just the sense that Kissinger was able to move in between the two. Obviously, what Jimmy Carter tried to do by bringing Anwar Sadat and Menachem Begin together was different. I mean, I think probably Jimmy Carter recognized that it would have been somewhat undignified for an American president to be traveling between the two. But he was doing something similar to what Henry Kissinger was, except, and in fact, as you may know, at Camp David, Carter actually shuttled between seeing Begin and Sadat. He actually moved between the two. He didn't bring them together. He would work with Sadat, and then he'd go over and see Begin. So it made the shuttle diplomacy a little bit easier in the negotiations. But Kissinger did do this, and it did involve, I think, a very in some ways he earned his Nobel Prize there more than Vietnam, and in the sense of trying to get the Egyptians and then the Syrians to disengage and pull back. But he had a skill for breaking down the larger issues between them into smaller parts that could be solved, and then try to build on that momentum to getting the bigger agreement. It's not foolproof, but he was able, in a sense, to create the conditions that allowed Carter to succeed later. I mean, there is a direct line, I think, from what he was doing in Egypt to what the ultimate Camp David agreement was and the long-term strategy of dealing with Egypt and Israel in that way. And it was an achievement. I think in a way, one of the things that struck me over the last few months is that they set up a system of American dominance in the Middle East that we are now retrenching from. The Egypt's changed, Syria's, all the rest of the change. But that was the stable environment equilibrium for a long period of time set up by Kissinger and then Carter and subsequent American presidents.
Thank you. So Kissinger was a successful Secretary of State, more successful than subsequent Secretaries of State?
I think he was. I mean, I think in the Middle East, he was very successful. He was less successful, of course, on Southeast Asia and Vietnam. Détente, you know, for a time was there, but, you know, it was not solidly built. It faced the problem of politics at home. The opening to China, although it didn't pursue further. I mean, I think of post-war American secretaries of state. And Kissinger himself puts himself next to Acheson, but behind Acheson. I think that's a fair judgment.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, as someone who lived in the 70s, in the early 70s, the feeling I got of Henry Kissinger, and I think many people, was that he was the adult in the room, and he was also the comfort food. In other words, if Henry was involved in it, you felt really good. Whether you understood the issue, understood who else was talking, just having him there was a source of encouragement, and you just felt okay. It's all going to work out.
I would agree with you in the sense that he did convey this, and then journalists certainly conveyed it, this overpowering sense of understanding and intellectual gravitas about these issues and the ability to talk about them and deal with them. And he worried in some ways that his popular image, the swinger and all the rest, some of that might detract, but in fact it actually served in some sense to enhance this sort of larger-than-life figure. It didn't last all the time. It's interesting because by the end of his administration, he was coming under a lot of attack. There was a point there, and a Gallup poll showed that he was the most admired American for 3 years in a row, 1973 through 75. But then it sort of started to come unwound by the end. And the political process, Reagan's attacks from the right, Carter's from the left, ultimately did him in. Although he, you know, he told me that he fully expected that he would have served another 4 years with Gerald Ford if Ford had pulled it out in 76.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. You said that people felt good about Henry Kissinger. When you talk to his staff, people who actually worked with him and under him, I'm not sure if the expression feeling good is all that justified, because he treated them, to put it mildly, quite harshly. Can you comment on that?
You know, it varied. He has his critics, but, you know, many of them feel that they were still doing very meaningful work. He could be a pain in the ass in every respect, and not appreciating their efforts and all the rest. But he pushed them. You know, there are differences, clearly. Some who split with him early, Anthony Lake, Morton Halper, and others who really don't like and dislike him intensely. But then there are Winston Lord, who later was ambassador to China, Peter Rodman, others who stayed with him all the way through and were very loyal. I've talked to some. You get those stories, but you also get the sense, well, yes, he was hard, but we were at the center of things. You felt you were at the center of things.
And another one would be Al Haig, who later became Secretary of State.
Well, who was something of a rival, too, yes. And a rival for Nixon's attention, and certainly they had a very complicated relationship.
Yeah, thank you. Any more questions? Yes, please.
Just a quick, perhaps frivolous one. Have you listened to all 3,700 hours?
No, thank you for asking. I've listened to a lot of them, way more than I should have, in the sense that if I'm ever going to write this book, I should stop. They are a little addictive. The Nixon Library has put them up now. I mean, they are available. You can go click on the Nixon Library, except during sequester when they shut it down. But you could click on the Nixon Library. You can go to all the different conversations. Now, there are excises for certain things are still clept out, but you can listen to the whole thing. I spent one day listening to the entire discussion of whether to bomb North Vietnam during December of 1972. That took place, and you hear it all. And they can be addictive. They're difficult. The ones I played here were the telephone ones, which are clearer. The ones in the Oval Office, you hear people click, the coffee cup goes down, and you're trying to listen to voices. It can drive you crazy, and probably accounts for my miserable mood sometimes. You have to remember that. that sometimes gets to me on that. I have to apologize to my family on it. But it is they are a really astonishing resource.
Talk to us briefly about the end of the Nixon, or the Ford administration, rather. Because as you rightly said, I think Kissinger's star was waning, and his popularity, which you very nicely outlined to us, his sex status, really, that wasn't talked about in 75, 76.
Well, he got married.
Well, how did that come about, that he wasn't as popular a politician now by the mid-70s than he had been in the early 70s, and how also did he recover his fortune, his influence, after having left office?
Well, he did and he didn't. After he left office, he recovered. He became a very rich man. He ran an associates thing, but he's also become very controversial. He's one of the few people, he can't go to some places, he can't go to some countries because they might arrest him, and he can't go to, for a time, he couldn't go to any, we couldn't get him at rallies and stuff because there'd always be protesters and he didn't want to deal with him. So he's had to deal with sort of a lot of antagonism. To go to the point about toward the end of the Ford administration, he was becoming a controversial figure. I think anyone in American life, if you're around long enough, the bloom of the rose fades. Is that what I'm getting at? It just does. He became seen more critically. More came out. In 1975 and 76, the Democrats won an overwhelming majority in the House and Senate. They had all sorts of hearings on different aspects of foreign policy. The Chilean issue, which I have not talked about today and could, about his involvement in trying to overthrow Allende, came out. There was criticism of his involvement in the SALT talks and whether he was informing the president. So a series of nitpicking issues also did it. The odd thing is he still retained about a 50 to 55% approval rating all the way through. It was 85 and 90%, which are very high figures for any American public figure in 73, 74, and then it dropped to about 50% by the end of the year. But he still had a lot of support.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay, we should let these people go.
one final okay. question. You will write your book. It will come out hopefully soon.
Hopefully,
and
yeah.
in the conclusion, tell us your overall conclusion of Kissinger's performance as Secretary of State.
Well, you know that you don't have a conclusion until you finish writing the book.
Come on. It must be in your mind. Somehow.
There is something. I mean, I do think he was an extraordinary political figure, and I do think he had at a moment in American history. I mean, he did become, in effect, a president of the United States unelected, the first foreign-born elected president, the first Jewish president. I mean, he was, for a time, this sort of central figure in American life, and it's a great story. Did he have a long-term influence on American foreign policy? He did have an extraordinary influence in educating a whole set of policymakers and others. There was never another Henry Kissinger, though, because Kissinger himself, the model of Kissinger, became something no one would allow in the future. No president was ever going to allow someone to become that powerful.
What about Brzezinski?
Brzezinski never became that. Never. No, I mean, Brzezinski never rivaled Carter in public acclaim. He was always a controversial figure, and Carter knew that. They became close, but he never had a public profile. People weren't talking about changing the Constitution to make him president the way they were with Kissinger. That was never there. And no one since, I would argue, because presidents, and that's why Kissinger also never had a government job after. Kissinger thought he'd be Secretary of State again after 76. He was only 53 years old when he left office. But he never was appointed to another real position in government because he was seen as being too ambitious for the camera and all the rest. The Reagan people thought about him, but they didn't. They let him do a commission on Central America. That was it. So, you know, I think he had a powerful, I'm going to argue that his influence and his writings and that constitute a huge part of thinking about American foreign policy. But I think in the end he did struggle with the fact that there are traditions in American foreign relations, the type of thing you're talking about with exceptionalism, which he could not grasp ultimately and could not come to terms with. And that, in that sense, his was only a partial success in the type of foreign policy he sought to bring.
Right. Thank you very much indeed. Thanks, Tom Schwartz. That was a very enlightening talk. We are all much better informed about Henry Kissinger's career, his successes and failures. Thanks an awful lot. And we have a final talk in this lecture series for this semester, and that is already next week on Tuesday, November the 19th. And surprise, surprise, we again deal with the 1970s, and we again will be dealing with Nixon and Kissinger. Caroline Eisenberg will talk about Nixon, Kissinger, and the national security state, Cold War lessons for the post-Cold War world. That will be a very different topic, a very different talk. So
a
despite
very different point of view.
Indeed, and a very different point of view. Despite Nixon and Kissinger featuring once again, it will be about very different matters. So please do come back next week, and thank you very much for coming tonight. Thank you. Thank you.